Grammy Award-winning singer-songwriter R. Kelly is facing trials in three states in both federal and state court. Kelly is accused of having sex with underage girls and, in the New York federal case, of giving a girl herpes without telling her about his infection. In 2008, Kelly was found not guilty in a child pornography case. The latest charges surfaced following the Lifetime documentary series Surviving R. Kelly, which featured alleged victims' stories of manipulation and abuse at the hands of Kelly.
I was a little girl in like a bad man's world. I never really recovered from it.
The New York federal case is set to go first and involves five victims and charges related to sex trafficking and racketeering. The herpes allegation is expected to be part of the jury selection process. A proposed questionnaire from the defense has this question included. Have you, a family member, a close friend, or a spouse or partner ever had a sexually transmitted disease? It's a question the defense wants in. Prosecutors are objecting, saying the question, among other reasons, is, quote, unnecessarily intrusive. Mike Leonard represents Robert Kelly.
There's going to be a whole panoply of evidence presented by the state about Mr. Kelly, about his health condition, about whether he allegedly transmitted an STD to somebody else, whether they knew that he had an STD. So clearly, it's evidence that the government's going to rely upon in its case in chief. So it would make obvious sense to ask the jurors questions about their familiarity with it, whether they've experienced themselves, whether they've been a victim of that type of STD, et cetera, et cetera. So to us, it's a no-brainer.
R. Kelly has consistently denied any wrongdoing, saying any relationships were consensual and the girls were all of the age of consent. He lost his composure during a 2019 interview with Gayle King on CBS This Morning.
I'm fighting for my life. Y'all killing me with this. I gave y'all 30 years of my career.
Robert.
30 years of my career.
Right now, you're obviously getting a one-sided take on R. Kelly. You're getting snippets of video that are produced and packaged in a way to make him the worst possible. And you got to remember, we're talking about allegations that in some instances are 20 to 25 years ago by persons who have already testified and or given statements under oath saying something that's absolutely contrary to what they're saying today.
Another obstacle for the defense is the fact that R. Kelly can't read.
Somewhat attuned to a case when you need an interpreter because your client doesn't speak the language.
I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly.
R. Kelly's illiteracy has not stopped him from churning out hit songs or even authoring his autobiography, Solar Coaster. But it is a disadvantage, claims his defense team, because he can't go through depositions or other discovery on his own.
All right, let's work through this. Let's bring in our special guest tonight. Joining us is the attorney representing several of R. Kelly's accusers. Gerald Griggs joins us tonight. Gerald, great to see you again. What I want to do is play for you a statement from this program by Steve Greenberg, the lead attorney for R. Kelly, and then get your response to what he is saying. And there's a lot of stuff in it, so we'll break it down. Let's take a listen.
There's these terrible allegations of these poor women in the documentary. And if you look at the social media that the women put out, I think that the public perception, what the documentary said about them, is not consistent with that. They're putting out all sorts of things on social media that just contradict what they said about R. Kelly. More to the point, when they did all of these searches, and I know we've discussed this before, nothing was discovered that's consistent with the allegations of that documentary. There's no evidence that he kept women hostage. There's no witnesses that are going to say that, as far as I know. There's no buckets filled with urine or anything like that. It was a very salacious documentary. It got great ratings. Hooray for the people who did it. They made lots of money. They destroyed a man's life. Now we'll go to trial and we'll get to the real facts and we'll prevail.
All right, Gerald, the documentary, how accurate from your perspective was it? And And from the people that you represent, what are they saying?
The documentary was quite accurate. It was just the tip of the iceberg. And hearing Mr. Greenberg make these allegations that he can't prove in court just underscore what these survivors and what these family members have been dealing with for decades with Mr. Kelly. His lawyers deflect for him. He deflects. But the evidence is quite clear. Both the state and federal authorities have tons of evidence, not to mention the plane tickets where he flew underage women across state lines for the purpose of sex. So I respectfully disagree with Mr. Greenberg's personification of the facts against Mr. Kelly. And I think in court, he will face an uphill battle. That's one of the reasons why he's not been able to get out on bond the numerous times he's tried.
The allegations here in New York, they're talking about like racketeering. They are alleging that he set up a complete operation, and the thing that motivated him to be this R&B superstar and money was all about getting access to women and underage girls. From your perspective, is that what you believe is going on here, that he kind of set up this entire world? And that was really what was the motivating factor behind all of it?
I believe the facts and the evidence will show that. I believe that there are witnesses and there's documentary evidence that proves exactly what you just said. And I also believe, given that one of his co-defendants has now taken a plea and admitting to silencing witnesses, I think that you will hear from witnesses. You may actually hear from the co-defendant. So I just think that there's an uphill battle for Mr. Kelly. I think that was an organization of enablers, as shown by the evidence. And I think that there are many, many other people that should be concerned about the status of this case and their own criminal culpability.
You know, he had a trial years ago and was found not guilty. Do you think the world has changed or the evidence has changed here?
I think the world has changed. I think the evidence has changed. I think the alleged victim in that particular case has decided to cooperate in this particular case, the Chicago case, as well as the Northern District of Illinois case. I believe she's cooperating. So I believe that the deck is stacked against Mr. Kelly. He faces an uphill battle. He faces a plethora of witnesses who are ready to tell the absolute truth, but they also have documents and other evidence. So I just think that it's going to be an interesting trial. I look forward to all the trials, and I look forward to Mr. Kelly spending a prolonged period of time in prison.
And you're 100% correct. All the trials. You're talking about three states, state, federal, everywhere, and we're tracking all of it. Gerald Griggs, appreciate your time tonight. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me, Vinny.
All right, folks, as we said, we are tracking it right now. We've got a pretrial conference scheduled for February 17th in the New York case. That's federal court. A tentative trial date of April 7th and a September 13th tentative trial date in Illinois. So, again, these are moving parts. You've got the COVID shutdown, but we'll stay on top of it.